So what I usually do is start my presentations with a story. And I will do that this time as well. And the story is about the big forest. Because all the animals in the big forest are kind of nervous. Because they kind of peeked at the humans. And they figured out that there's something to be scared of. And that something is the future. Human beings are worrying about the future all the time. So animals should do that too, right? So then they're like, well, what should we do about that future? So they once again went to the humans and saw, you prepare for the future with a school. So the animals are like, well, that's the solution. We should start our own school. School in the forest will be fine. So it was this huge gathering in the middle of the forest. All the animals came together because they needed to decide on the curriculum. What are we going to teach in our school? So everybody had something to say. You know, the deer are like running. Only thing that's important, run like a wind. And the squirrels like, you know, climbing and collecting nuts. And then, you know, the otters like, you know, swimming and building dams. And like, they all had their little say. So after a while, they came to this beautiful program with a little bit of running, a little bit of climbing, a little bit of digging, a little bit of collecting nuts. Everything was there. So, of course, after summer you start, because that's what a school does, you start after summer. So all the animals came together. And all the young ones were standing there, the little deer, and the little duck, and the little squirrel. They were all ready for the new school. And so it started out with the running lesson. Deer, completely happy. Otter, not so much. Squirrel's having some trouble. But the next lesson was climbing. So no problem. Squirrel up the tree. Now, the geese got disqualified because they flew up. It's not a flying lesson, it's a climbing lesson. So that creates some issues. And the next one was swimming lessons. So the squirrel got like this big trauma because he was thrown into the water. It was not a big success. And you know, after a couple of running lessons, the swimming didn't go so well for the duck either, because you know, it's a little fast, he had like all the little blisters and stuff like that, it didn't go very well. So after a while, some of the animals started breaking down a little bit. But at the end of the year, everybody was so curious. What is the animal that's best prepared for the future? Which of the animals got through the school the best? Well, and at the end of the year, they figured out that like the biggest success of the forest is the weasel. Because he can climb a little, he can swim a little, he can run a little, he can do everything a little bit. And what more could we want if we want to prepare our young for the future? The question is, could there be like a metaphor in this story? So, well, you just had a pretty elaborate introduction of who I am. Tel Kundering, unpronounceable name in English, so don't bother trying. And I've been engaged in education quite a bit in my life. And I started out, I was just having a conversation, like, why do you do something like this? Because I got stuck in education. I was one of those called near dropouts. I didn't end up dropping out, but I went to three different high schools for like taking 2 years longer at the end. And I failed my final exam in math, while at the same time I was working as a software architect for a computer company. So that is kind of like a weird conclusion, and I've been tested for the technical people among you. I did the rate in advanced matrices and scored at like the top level in that. So that created like this big disconnect for me. Like, it's been proven that I've got analytical ability, but still I'm failing all my math exams. Like, how is it possible that you can have proven talent but no results? And that's probably why a lot of you are here. Because you figure that out. Like, there's a lot of talented people in the world, but the result does not equal their talent. There's something in between the talent and what is happening that is not connecting up. I actually swore never to get into an educational institution the rest of my life after that, which wasn't a big success, I can tell you. I started an IT company, and at the side I did a lot of training in creative problem solving, accelerated learning, a lot of other subjects, but how to use that mind. How can you translate something that's in your head into the world? Well, then I became a trainer. I set up classes with gifted students, trying to answer the same question, how do you learn? Because that's the dominating question that I always had. Like, how do you do that? Like, how to operationally sit down and learn something? Like, you don't really get an answer in most schools. So I really focused on that, gave training, and that went into a foundation that set up full-time gifted programs. That became an educational consulting company, and after that I set up a gifted dropout center. And like every time I was like, well, you know, nobody's doing something about this, well, let's try to see what we can do. The most recent step is setting up a school of understanding, a regular public school, publicly funded, not specifically aimed at the gifted students, gifted education often is a patch on regular education. So we're trying to fix some problems with regular education so our gifted kids don't suffer. But if the foundation is designed wrong, then you can patch all you want, but you're probably not going to get there. So I'm trying to figure out, like, if we redesign education from the ground up, like some of you actually have done, then a lot of the problems we have with gifted education don't even show up anymore. Like all these long discussions about acceleration, I was just at the Data Institute 2 weeks ago, like there's no discussion about skipping grades or stuff like that. If you give them the materials they need, you don't have to have a skipping grade discussion. So design education differently, and then there's still some stuff that's really giftedness specific, but it's a lot less than it is now. They're just kind of like the people who show, like the canaries in the mines that show that the system is wrong. Like they're the ones who suffer. And as a result of that, I set up some other companies, including Take On Talents, to spread the things that I've learned in English language as well. So that's why I'm traveling around the US right now for about 6 months to share as much as I can. And I set up a software company because I'm finding it hard to track students. Like portfolio management is a lot of work if you're going to do that by hand, and it's hard to find software that supports you. So I'm creating that myself as well. So I'm trying to attack it from as many angles as possible. So what are we going to do? I'm going to give you a kind of an overview of a lot of different theories, but what I think is really important is coming back to practical stuff. You should be able to go home and think, like, this is something I'm going to try out tomorrow. We can theorize all we want. There's like a million philosophies on giftedness, but a lot of them don't really help you answer the question, what do I do differently? How can I improve the life of a gifted kid? So I think it's really important to bring it back to that. You do need some background on the way I look at the world. You hear my speed of talking. I'm kind of enthusiastic. I share a lot. I'm going to do this for an hour. I'm sorry. It's recorded on video, so some people watch it afterwards on YouTube. You can play it at half speed, so you've got 2 hours to take. But be cherry picking. You know, you don't have to agree with everything. If you don't agree, just leave it and move on. Something else will come back, and probably you'll find something to your liking. So don't get stuck too much on things. The materials I'm covering today, I could talk about for like 10 or 20 days. You've got like year-long teacher training and administrative programs. So it's going to be an introduction or an overview. But I'm trying to give you as much as possible. I'm going to send the presentation afterwards, so don't worry about writing along or something on the screen. You're going to take pictures. I'll make sure you get it through and we'll get it to you somehow. And afterwards we'll have a panel discussion, so you get to ask questions as well. There's some other brilliant people as well, so that's going to be a lot of fun. I do have to put in a disclaimer. Because we're doing kind of like a fast version, usually when I can choose between theoretically very precise or a fun story, I'll opt for the story. It's more fun as a way of being together, but I am going to generalize. So I apologize up front, you know, I'm not going to give all the nuances. Some people kind of get frustrated in that, but no, that's the case. If you want to have references, 9 out of 10 times I've got them. Tell you what research is based on, stuff like that. It just doesn't make for a very fun evening to go through all of that together. So this is the part of the presentation where I'm supposed to talk about what giftedness is. And that's where I immediately get stuck. Because this is the simplest model. We all know it, like Ranzulli's model, the triad model, you've got creativity, above average ability, and task commitment. And that together gives gifted behavior. There's a little bit of a problem in that. And I've got a Dutch cartoon, I've translated for your benefit, and that explains that. Fok and Sukke got a report card for that kid. Failing all subjects, bad attitude, disruptive behavior, oh, he's not a gift. What do you think? And a lot of you will recognize this, right? Like, this is like almost a checklist of, probably not kids gifted. But if we're going to look at this model, he can be. Because I don't see positive creativity, I don't see task commitment, I don't see above average ability. So if we're going to use all these gifted models, and they just get more complicated, I mean, you've got like a multi-factor Gagne model that's got like a 32 interrelated parts that go in and out and stuff like that, like if we're going to use that as being a gatekeeper and saying, oh, you're not gifted because you're missing one of the 32 items, like that's not going to help anybody. So I try to look at it from kind of like a different view. First I'm going to tell a story about it, then I'm going to kind of support it with some theory. A couple of years ago, I went to a meditation retreat. A 10-day retreat, 10 days long, vow of silence. Can you imagine me being silent for 10 days? But the height of every day was like in the evening at 7 o'clock, we got a presentation of the Guru Goenka. And Goenka would tell stories about ancient India and Pune. And one of the stories always stuck with me, because it's a story about three children. There's three children, and they're just running around the house, the three brothers, and their mother wants to cook. He needs oil, so what do you do as a mother? You send one of your children. You say, here's like a vase, here's money, go to the market, get me some oil. So the first one goes out, buys the oil, comes back, but he trips. He trips, he falls, loses most of the oil, and comes back and says, Mom, it's awful, I fell, I lost all of my oil. Mom, like, oh yeah, that's kind of a problem, but, well, I'll send my second son. So she gives him the vase, gives him the money, second son goes out, and comes back, he also trips. He comes back and says, Mom, best thing ever happened. I fell, I'm in one piece, the vase is in one piece, I even saved some of the oil too. How cool is that? So Mom's like, oh, not that cool. Well, third son, right? I mean, she still needs the oil to cook, so third one goes out, goes to the market, gets his vase, comes back, he also trips. I suspect some of the problems in the family, by the way. He comes home and he says, Mom, I fell, I'm in one piece, the vase is in one piece, I saved some of the oil, I lost most of it. But what I will do is I will go back to the market and I will work for this merchant for an hour. I will make enough money to buy a new vase of oil. And in that we can see three different ways to look at the world. The first one is the pessimist. You know, everything is terrible, oh no, something awful happened. The second is the optimist. It's awesome, you know, whatever happened. And they're both not very functional. I mean, they're both equally true or not true. But the third one's most interesting. It's not is it good or bad, but what can I do to make it better? And that's like a driving question in my life. What can I do to make it better? And if I could give counselors only one question they could use in their entire life, it's what are you going to do to make things better? What are you? A child must always remain the owner of his own problems. However hard you want to try, we cannot solve a child's problems. They have to do it themselves. What are you going to do? Not talk about, not complain about, not whine about. What are you going to do? And to make it better, not happily ever after, but better than it's now. And if I'm in a really good mood, I might add, what can I do to help you? But only when I'm in a good mood. But this is like a question to approach any problem you run into. What can we do to make this better? So if you take a little bit more of a theoretical approach, there's two types of diagnosis. You've got classifying diagnosis, and you've got operational. Classifying diagnosis has as its viewpoint that when somebody comes in, first you need to figure out what are you? What is the box that you fit into? Because if I know what box you fit into, then I can do the things that are supposed to go with this box. Not supposed to go with you, but go with the box. So if I got the right box, if I got the right activity, then I'll be fine. And actually that what should you do is kind of like an optional step. The most important thing is to determine the right box. Operational diagnosis asks, what do you need? And how can I give it to you? So we'll skip the entire box bit. Because when you figure out, like when you've got in a classroom, you've got two kids, and one didn't make the threshold of officially being designated clinically HDD, but he's bouncing all over the place and like completely unruly. And next to him is a kid who just made it into the official ADD box, functioning really well, learned all kinds of coping mechanisms, through which he's functioning well. Then the kid in the box, ADD, will get the recommendation to get medication and stuff like that, and the other kid will not because he didn't fit into the box. So we should ask, what do you need? And some kids might need medication. Actually, it is beneficial for a small group. A group also doesn't have any use for it because they don't have a problem that has a need for that solution. So it really determines on what the goal is, and actually the label's optional. Including gifted, as far as I'm concerned. I don't think giftedness has a specific function. If there's a need that is met by applying the label giftedness, I'm happy to provide it. But the point is not to provide the label. Like, that's not an end result. That could be one of your interventions. So that has to do with your goal. And so if the approach depends on the goal, what is the goal? So what we can do now is differentiate between types of gifted and levels of giftedness and all the labels and talk about acceleration and stuff like that. But that's all about classification and tweaking the current education system, which is useful worldwide. I mean, we could spend like a week on that. But But that's not what we're going to do today. I would like to take a little bit more of a straight-up approach. We want those kids to be happy and to be successful. Well, let's make that the goal then and figure out what can we do to make them more happy, to make them more successful. And let's see what's needed for that. These are, by the way, universal themes. If you learn something that might make you happier, it's allowed to apply it in your life. You know, it doesn't have to be just really good. So, who knows? So what is needed for success and what is needed for happiness? Happiness is kind of like, I've got some problems with the world because this might suggest that it's all about just positive feelings. And as long as you feel good, everything is fine. And this is where I'm really happy with positive psychology. Martin Seligman did a lot of research. And he says, well, let's talk about well-being. Well-being is a lot more holistic and an integral approach of looking at what it is. So what is needed for well-being? Well, Martin Seligman did some research into that. And the first question is, what is well-being? Actually, more precisely, what types of well-being are there? Because there are different types of well-being. And Martin Seligman is actually one of the researchers who originally did the research into learned helplessness. Learned helplessness, the factor that people and actually animals can get into a state of not trying to solve their problems anymore because they've given up. They're hopeless about their future, so they won't try to improve it anymore. One of the things that kind of bugged him for a long time is that there is like a small percentage that's immune to that. So it's like a small percentage of the dogs, a small percentage of the people, it's almost impossible to get them learned helpless, which of course is a good thing, but as research is kind of like a bummer, because your research wasn't bad. Luckily it was statistically insignificant, but it's still bugged. Like, how is that possible? And that was actually a foundation of positive psychology, researching that fringe group. What's the difference between the people who are immune to learned helplessness and what? Turns out it's learned optimism, by the way, it's a specific factor. But he got some grants, and he got money funded, and he actually started the field. But he said a lot of psychology is surrounding the disease model, figuring out all the ways people can be broken and fixing them. But the difficult thing is that you can be broken and happy. And you can be completely fixed, but unhappy. So apparently these are unrelated factors. So we should research what makes people happy or what promotes well-being and what makes sure that we have optimal functioning. So let's ask that question and do research, and actually do double-blind studies and stuff like that. So what I'm going to do is going to give you the popular psychology version of this research, and then I'm going to expand it a little bit into a more technical version of it. Tony C, founder of Zappos, the shoe stores online, he wrote a book called Delivering Happiness, and he's applied a lot of the work, so that's where this model comes from. And he talks about the three levels of happiness. And the lowest level of happiness is rockstar happiness. Rockstar happiness is when you get what you want. I want more money, I get more money, now I'm happy. You know, I want a new house, I get a new house, now I'm happy. I want a new partner, I get a new partner, now I'm happy. There's two problems with that. First problem with rockstar happiness is that you get kind of like happiness inflation. That which is enough to be happy at some point won't be enough at a later point. Case in point, think about the first salary you got and how much you had to work for that. And how happy you were to get that. And imagine getting exactly the same amount of money now for the same amount of work. I don't think you won't have the same amount of happiness. So inflation occur. You need more money to have the same amount of happiness. A second problem is that it has a pretty short shelf. It takes about 8 months on average for it to die away. They've shown it with people who won the lottery. Doesn't matter how much money you won, within 8 months you're at the same level of happiness you had before. Regardless what you did with the money and how much you won. I see some of you thinking like, give me the money, I'll show you how to return. Seriously? 8 months and you'll be back to the previous happiness level. The biggest problem is like our Western society is built around this model. It's built around the model that there will be one day and then you will have everything you ever wanted and then you will be permanently happy. And that day is actually going to come. The day when you have everything you ever thought you wanted. And that day is called the beginning of your midlife crisis. Because you have everything you ever wanted and you're like, where is my happiness? I'm supposed to be happy now. Why am I not getting it? So, yeah, new solution, right? The guy's solution, red Volkswagen, you bought that. 8 months later, didn't really solve anything. So you should try to find a higher level of happiness. Flow, passion, and engagement. Finding something that brings you flow. Wonderful. How do you choose it? How do you, of course, we're going to test you afterwards if you can spell it. He did a lot of research into flow. That timeless state where you forget time, eating, everything, because you're so engaged in the thing you're doing. What you need is an area you're interested in and a challenge level that's not too high because you get frustrated, not too low because you get bored, but something in between. Then you're in flow. And that can happen your entire life. You can be 78 and you can still get into flow, right? And
yeah.
Yeah. You can always get into flow, you can always start. Like there's no reason why at any point you wouldn't be able. The highest level in this model at least of happiness is meaning. Knowing you made a difference. And especially as a teacher, it's not like you're looking at your salary and thinking like, yay, it works for happiness. You're not doing like all the fake administration work and thinking like, well, this gives me flow. But knowing that you made a difference. Like there's a group of students that now has a different life because of what I did. And that can keep you going for 6 months, maybe even 6 years, just thinking back of, wow, I made a difference. That meaning. Challenges, however, that not all students reach all these levels of happiness, especially the gifted ones. I was talking with a pretty cynical kid, actually, and I was asking, like, what's the end result of education? He said, well, I know what the end result of education is because I calculated it. Calculated it. He says, well, yeah, it's 6 dumpsters full of paper. Because I calculated this many sheets a week, this many weeks a year, this many years of education, that's like 6 dumpsters. The exchange rate is actually pretty bad because I have to hand them in and I get like 1 sheet of paper back. That's the current exchange rate, so that's not much point. But the cynical nature of that response shows how little meaning he experienced. He didn't see any meaning in education whatsoever, and that's why he was the way he was. Getting the right challenge level, getting into flow, you need to be able to do it in an area you're interested at your level. So many kids that never figured that out, they never got anything at their level. They don't even know what flow is. And if you have a kid that's not been in flow for a long enough time, they'll actually be scared of it. They will actually have a threshold in getting into it because it's kind of like you have to push yourself because they've never done it. They will actually resist going into flow. So now you've got a problem of you want to get them there, but how are you going to get them there? So a lot of these kids are just brought back to the lowest level of happiness. Rocks of happiness. If you give them a carrot, they'll run a little bit. If you threaten a stick, they'll walk a little bit. But as soon as the carrot's gone, as soon as the stick's gone, nothing. And actually, somebody defined intelligence as getting a maximum result with a minimum of resources. And that actually is the smartest thing to do. If there are no carrots and no sticks nearby, and you don't know what the flow of meaning is, the best thing to do is as little as possible. Save your energy for the things that you care about, which might be gaming, or might be friends, or social connections, stuff like that. So a little bit more elaborate version is what he calls the PERMA model. PERMA model, later on he added 2 factors. One is relationships. We inherently get well-being from positive, constructive relationships with other people. The thing is, for a constructive relationship, somebody needs to be able to step into my shoes and understand my world. But if I've got like 30 IQ points more than you do, the chances are of you understanding my world are perfectly zero. Not because you're a bad person, but just because I think about different things. If I'm 7 years old and I think about life and death, then probably I'm not going to have a lot of good conversations with people around me because they don't. That doesn't make them bad people, but that doesn't make that I don't experience positive relationships. An achievement is that point where you challenge yourself beyond what you thought you were capable of and do it. But that is a pretty tall order if you've got a pretty high IQ. So this would be well-being, like getting all these things. Later on we're going to talk about how to achieve them, like how to contribute to all these factors. So we're going to go to the other one, because we want well-being and success. What is needed for success, and especially if you're a student? That depends on the future you're going towards. Depending on the future, the definition of success is different. Because if your future is going to be a known world, then education needs to do something different from when you go into an unknown. Imagine being a farmer 150 years ago. You are going into a known world, because your world is going to be exactly the same as your dad's. So if you do exactly the same thing that your parents did, you will be successful. So you need knowledge. You need to know the right way. If you tell me the right way and I do the right way too, then we'll be fine. But then, 50 years ago, we started encountering unknown worlds. A lawyer, you don't go to law school and then they tell you, you know, give these answers, you'll win in court. Like, that's not how it works. But if you apply these analytical techniques, if you apply these debating techniques, if you argue in a specific way, if you learn these skills, then you'll be successful. Because you're going into all kinds of situations that are unknown, but knowable. We can know the types of situations you get into, and that we can prepare you for. And that you do with skills. Same with a doctor. We know the kind of situations you go into. You don't know exactly what they are, but they roughly know what they are, so you can teach the skills. But now we're slowly moving to an unknowable world. You've got somebody like Elon Musk talking about going to Mars. Like, imagine writing the go to Mars curriculum in 8 easy steps. What is life going to be like there? That'd be awesome to do that, but like, it's impossible, because there's no way of knowing what we're going to run into. If you want to prepare somebody for a world and you don't know what that world's going to be like, then they need life attitude and self-awareness. Because if they're persevering, if they're optimistic, if they like learning, if they know what their talents are, it doesn't really matter where they end up, they'll be fine. Because they can use that awareness to learn skills, they can use skills to acquire knowledge, and that combination will make that in the end, they will be fine. And that's kind of like the test that I usually take if you really want to design education. I call it like the Rome Mars test. If you want to teach them something, you want to teach them something universal, because that's what's going to be timeless. So if something's going to be useful, whether you're going to be in ancient Rome 2,000 years ago, or whether you're going to be in Mars 200 years from now, if it's functional in both areas, probably it's kind of universal. So persevering, if you're in ancient Rome, you're going to be popular. If you're going to be on Mars, you're going to be popular. Knowing the 50 states of the US 2,000 years ago, not so useful. In 200 years on Mars, not so useful. So knowledge has a very short shelf life. Skills, a little bit longer. Most of the skills, like if you talk about general skills like goal setting and communications and stuff like that, that's pretty universal. Very specific skills, you know, how to conjugate a verb, maybe a little bit more specific. So this is a way of looking at like what's going to be valuable in the long term, what isn't. Eric Hoffman had a great quote: in times of change, the learners will inherit the earth, while the learned will find themselves beautifully equipped for a world that no longer exists. And that's what's happening. You cannot be a learner about the world that's coming. You can be a learner about the world that's coming. So being successful requires all these things. A little short side note, like, is the world really going to be unknowable? Is the future going to be unknowable? I really believe that change is coming. And one of the books I'm writing now is A Bright Future for a Bright Mind. It's actually a project I'm working on with James Webb. That's how I got to meet him. It's about the world is changing and what's it going to require from our bright minds. And what can our bright minds contribute to solving the problems that are coming. So the first part is just proving that the world is actually going to change. Because a lot of people are kind of skeptical about it. You know, we've been talking for 50 years about going to the moon and going to Mars and stuff like that, but not a lot has happened. Things are really changing. Some of you might know this guy, Ray Kurzweil. He's actually the head futurologist at Google, which is kind of thing to be at Google and there being the futurologist. And he's talking about the singularity point. He's talking about the point where change is going so fast that it's impossible to keep up with. And one of the charts they often use is this. Looking at the way that computing power is developing, it seems to be going pretty slow, but as it's going exponentially, it's going faster and faster. There's going to be a moment that a computer has the same computational power as our entire human brain. But as it doubles in about every 18 months, that same computer is, for the same price, as smart as 2 brains. And 18 months, as 4 brains. one entity. So it's conceivable at some point that a computer is going to be as smart as a human being, or at least take over a lot of its functions. And you see a lot of that happening recently. Computers winning competitions from human beings, or outperforming them in translation, or in image recognition, or stuff like that. It's still pretty specific, but if you see the speed at which it is happening, and the world's actually going to change because of that. We're going to get autonomous vehicles. This is not quite autonomous, but actually in this region, you know, you've got way more driving around. You can order a car that has no driver in it. Almost every large car manufacturer has promised to get us one in 5 years. I mean, if it was just Tesla or just GM or just Google, they might fail. But if there's like 13 companies at the same time doing it and setting that goal, then one of them is going to succeed. But in the US alone, we're talking about 4 million jobs. 4 million jobs driving stuff for people around. Like, that's 4 million people who are probably going to be out of a job in 10 years. What are they going to do? And no, well, there's no way of answering that question definitively. We can have a lot of theories about it, but we can't have a definitive answer on it. And if you kind of feel safe, then you're probably going to be more, you know, work-type jobs, physical, vocational. Watson, the IBM artificial machine, starting to do paralegal work, and some research on what parts of legal can expect to not have as many jobs anymore. And that's not just like the basic paralegal work, but more and more complex work is going to be done by computers, and actually better than human beings could ever do it. Same goes for medicine. So a lot of areas are going to be disrupted. A lot of jobs are going to change, and we don't really know what's going to come back for them. So we need to find a way to develop our self-awareness, develop our life attitude, to be ready to deal with those things. Because if we have the skills, if we have the life attitude and self-awareness, then we'll be able to deal with whatever disruptions come. As opposed to the tendency now is to try to find the new recipe. Like, okay, let's change the school system once, and then we'll be done with it. But it's going to change every 10 years. Because once we've had this change, the next one is going to be around the corner, and probably it's going to be faster than this one, and even faster. So we need people to be able to deal with that. And actually dealing with the unknowable, that's actually the bread and butter of this region, right? So if you're going to look at the difference between living in Cubeville and living in Silicon Valley, that actually translates pretty well to the difference between the school systems, the traditional school system and maybe a more innovative type. Because they design their education in a different way. They look at education in a different way. So if you look at well-being, in Cubeville, if you work in Cubeville, your happiness comes from positive emotions. Working your way up, getting a better salary check, and getting that at a steady pace that's kind of in line with your inflation. Like, if those two kind of match up, you're kind of happy. Engagement, yeah, not so much. Probably not at work, but maybe on your mobile phone or something you're doing outside, your fantasy football league or something like that. Your relationships are probably what's going to get you through the day. Social relationship with other people, meaning and achievement are virtually non-existent. So there's much more onus on the positive emotion side. If you combine that with a startup, it's completely the other way around. Like, positive emotions, probably not a lot. You don't sleep enough, you don't eat well, you're like, your body feels like crap, you live on caffeine and painkillers and stuff like that. But boy, are you in flow. You know, you're reaching the maximum potential, and probably you're doing something that you think is meaningful. And you have a relationship, you're like fighting this war together with other people, like changing the world, and we're gonna do it. And if you make it, you actually reach an achievement point. So it's a completely different model of motivation that actually is completely mimicked in education. A traditional school, you get through the day well, if you got your allowance this week, and you got a decent grade, positive relationship will get you through the day, flow is almost non-existent, meaning, let's not talk about that. Achievement's been a long time since I heard that. As opposed to an innovative school. Flips it around, it's not very comfortable being there. If you're being like frustrated all the time and have to do weird new stuff, but boy are you in flow. And you know the meaning, but you know why you're doing things and where you're going and you're achieving stuff and you're related to other people, making a change. So it's a completely different way of designing it. And the same way with success. Cubeville, knowledge is power. And you shouldn't prevent other people from having that knowledge, because if you keep other people stupid, you might stay in the same place longer and you get promoted faster. Skills, kind of, life attitude, let's not go there. self-awareness, we try to avoid that at all costs. Because then you start thinking about life. A startup, exactly the opposite. You know, knowledge is as a half-life of about like 2 weeks, if you need to know something different every time, but your skills are gonna get you through that, and your perseverance, your vision, your self-awareness of this is stuff I can do, but this is stuff I need to outsource. And that's what's gonna get you through those first wild periods. Traditional school, the same thing. Knowledge gap is the reason that the teacher has his authority. I know more than you do, and because you don't know it, I'm your boss. Skills, we talked about a little bit, life attitude, virtually non-existent. Self-awareness is not a subject because we've got an average student and that's what you have to be. And you can be a good average student or you can be a bad average student. Like those are your options. As opposed to more of what I call a learning ecosystem. Because then it's not about knowledge. Because knowledge, we've got internet for that. Like you can just look it up, watch something on YouTube. We're gonna work on your skills. What is your life attitude? Did you persevere in your previous project? Like, are we doing 360 degree feedback? Self-awareness, you need to find out who you are, what your strengths are, because you're different from somebody else. And the sooner you learn that, and the sooner you're going to maximize on those talents and skills, the better off you'll be, the more successful you'll be. So it's a completely different model. So that was actually a lot of background for us to kind of try to get concrete now. Like, what can you do with that? Step one is always psychoeducation. No, it's not psychoeducation. It's psychoeducation. We try to teach this stuff to kids. And that's a cool thing about working with gifted kids. You can explain them everything. You know, just get out your teacher's manual and start reading it out to them. That's what we're going to do today. You know, this is what a lesson looks like. Help me design it. Talk about life attitude. There's this field called positive psychology. Let's talk about the 5 types of well-being. Don't expect them to be able to apply it. We'll talk about it a little bit later. The fact that they can cognitively grasp it is a completely different concept from them being able to embody it and implement it. That's it. 3 things you can do as both a teacher and a parent. The first is attribute value to it. If you're going to say, oh, you didn't get an A+, while your kid tried something new for a project, then you're attributing value to standardized testing and you're not attributing value to trial and error. Well, if you say, I don't even care what the kid comes in and says, I got an A+. And you're like, well, I don't really care. Like, did you try something new? Did you learn something new? What happened today? Then you're attributing value, and your kid will follow that. Not in the first day, not in the first week. But if you year after year keep saying, you know, I don't care about those grades, but did you learn something new? Did you persevere? Were you happy learning something new? Then they're going to focus on that. Be a role model. If you're going to be perfect all the time, then your kids are going to try things. Well, if you're going to be like, oh man, I made a mistake. I did some really stupid last week. Like, this is what I did, and this is how I dealt with it. Oops. As opposed to, say, trying to like brush it away or ignore it or even make a mistake and try to make the kids feel bad about it when they kind of try to catch you in it. Like, that makes a huge difference. And talk about it. Just make this the subject to talk about. Watch some YouTube videos, let them watch this video, and go through it together. Say, like, hey, do you recognize this? What do you think? So, if we're going to try to do some stuff, what are practical like applications of all these things I've been talking about? Positive emotions, try to do as little with it as possible. Like you really want to train kids not to be relying on positive emotions as their primary drive for happiness. Because this is what's going to get you your, not just your midlife crisis, but by now we've got like a quarter life crisis. We're accelerating there as well. But they need to learn that that's all temporary. So don't try to focus on that. Try to focus on engagement. The classical advice, of course, is differentiation. Anne was just talking about, you know, about placement testing to figure out where exactly are you so we can go to the next level. We need to train you in what I call frustration tolerance. Being tolerant for the fact that if you want to do something worthwhile, you are going to get frustrated. Because otherwise it wasn't hard enough. Like, that's the point of it. And try to tie goals in with existent engagement. What do I mean by that? Like, if, for instance, your son comes in or a boy comes in and says, like, you know, I got this really cool video game, then your first tendency might not be to be enthusiastic about that. But still, you can see, like, in that world of yours, what could you do to challenge yourself? Like, what could you do to not do the same level for a 200th time, but do it a different way. Or try to reach a new level. Or try to recreate it in Minecraft or something, right? But do something within their world to challenge them. That's actually an easier way than to try to find a new area from scratch, get them enthusiastic, then get them through frustration tolerance, and then get them into flow. Like, that's a long route. It's easier to tie it in with something that they're interested in themselves. But it might be random things, like, I would like to play that guitar song. Like, cool, this is a great way to practice your frustration tolerance. See if we can get you there. Relationship. That's actually what most people who had a tough school period afterwards say that got them through it. Like, if you have people who had a really tough time in their teenage years, 9 out of 10 times they will point at positive relationships with that which got them through. It's either a positive relationship with a teacher or a counselor who had faith in them, or it was some kind of a group that they were part of, like a summer camp or like a weekend program or stuff like that, where they could check in and be normal. Just be yourself, as opposed to having to play the role. And that is really important. Find a place where a kid can be himself. And that's already one of the values, like we were just talking about twice exceptional programs, remember the gift of dropout program. Just being in a place where just being yourself is okay. Like, that already makes a world of a difference. And James Webb talks about the process of immunization, inoculation. By doing that, you kind of become immune. Even if you just have that for like 1 year, or just one summer school program, you know, I'm not crazy. There is a place in the world where I can be this. Even if the rest of the world and the rest of my life doesn't believe it, there is a place where I can be this. And you can't imagine the difference it makes between having had that experience or never having had that experience. And most of you probably actually recognize that that's why you're sitting here. This is kind of your, like your acceleration group. Sitting together with other people who understand you and have those relationships. Meaning, Martin Seligman talks about values in action. Meaning is when you value something, you think something's important, and then you do something about it. Like I said, we set up a school of understanding, like a regular public school, and one of the things they ran into is that the side of our building got like, graffiti all over it. And then they were like, what is our value? It's like positivity. And we don't like that the wall is covered with all kinds of negative stuff. So they spent an entire afternoon taking chalk and stuff like that to fill all the sidewalks around our school with positive messages. Hey, have a great day, I'm happy with you, and so nice to have you here. Just because their value is happiness, that's what they decided together, and they put it into action. And they talked about it for weeks and weeks afterwards, because they did something with that value. It's not just like a mental, you know, socialist armchair kind of thing, like, I think this is important, now I'm doing something. I'm moving. So turn your values and put them in action. And it's actually not hard on this. What do you think is important? What can you do with it today? Like, those are the questions. Work on that. And achievements, as they call it in the management literature, B-hacks, big, hairy, audacious goals. Find something that is just at the edge of, whoa, if you can do that, that'd be awesome. Like, that feeling like could be, I think we could. If you can do that and have a project like that going on for like 3 months or whatever, like just at the edge of where you believe you can do it, but it's hard, that gives you a feeling of achievement. And Maureen Meyer talked about, especially with twice exceptional students, with the combination of a high challenge but a low threshold. And a lot of gifted kids won't accept small steps. That's kind of like bored, right? But if you put this really huge goal out there, they get lost. They miss the self-regulation, the executive skills to be able to get there. So that's our job as coaches. Set that faraway goal, but make it small and decide, like, what are we going to do today? And what would be a good goal for the coming hour? And then we can take steps and get closer and closer. And now we're tying these two together. So these are some things you can do with it. Success. Knowledge. Value memorization in school does. I'm not a big fan of memorization, like I was really bad at it in school, but I also think that the half-life of knowledge can be shorter and shorter. The thing is, if your kid's going to be in school for about 10 years, he's going to rely on a lot of memorization. So you better learn the skill as early as possible to evaluate. If school does, because my tendency, at least if I'm talking as a parent, is to say, it's not important, you know, later in life you won't need it. But if I don't value it, they won't value it. and they're going to push against memorization, and they're going to get low scores, and it's going to hinder them in the rest of their life. As opposed to just taking the time to learn some memorization techniques, there's like a million of them, and that makes life so much easier. The rest of it, do the 80-20 approach. You'll go for overview. So try to learn the most important things and mostly learn the overview. One of the specific advice I give, especially to slightly older kids, is learn speed reading, and it's always better to speed read 5 books than to really read 1 book. Because if you speed read 5 books, now you've got like 5 authors' opinions, and if they all talk about the same thing, probably it's important. Well, if you read 1 book, you might get the wrong one, a stupid author, and you get the wrong like theory. It's better to have like 5 theories. And even if you're going to read a book at all, first read 5 books and then read 1 of them, but then read the best of the 5. That makes more sense. So be smart in the way you acquire your knowledge. Skills. Most important, like here, talk with a lot of people here, is executive skills. Executive skills, executive function. Like that's the basis of almost everything you do. And don't make it more complicated than it needs to be. I mean, it's like a bunch of books about it, Dawson Word stuff on it, and that you're working on it, Annabelle. The different skills, like there's a lot of different approaches to measure it and train it. Often the simplest is best. In our school, we have School of Understanding, we do life lessons. So every morning, you've got like half an hour spent on life attitude, self-awareness and skills. So we're training prolonged focused attention. We tried a lot of things. The most popular one by far is the game, look at the stopwatch. Two kids sit there looking at the stopwatch, and the competition is who can do it for the longest. The hardest part is finding like the jury who's going to check one because they get this correct. But that actually worked better than all kinds of really technical crap. Seriously. Task initiation. How to get from right here to actually executing it. Competition in the classroom. Boys versus the girls. The boys could make a mess of the classroom, and the girls had to clean it up, and we had a stopwatch. The girls could make a mess of the classroom, the boys had to clean it up. And they timed it. They got to the point where they could like take the entire classroom upside down, and in 1 minute and 47 seconds, have completely put back together again. Everything in the place where it needed to be. And because it was a competition, they were so focused on doing it. They were learning cooperation and how to put stuff away. Like, I don't know if you ever tried to get your kid to put anything away, let alone the entire classroom. But these are the kind of things where you train these skills. So make them small, big challenge, low threshold. These are small activities that you can do that will train kids to become better at this. And so self-regulation, learning, and time management, I think, are the most important skills that you can build. Life attitude, a lot of stuff from positive psychology about growth mindset, hopefulness, and learned optimism. This you could talk about for days. The most important thing is, again, what do you get feedback on? What you get feedback on is apparently the value. And if you say you think a growth mindset is important, and here is your A+ for your knowledge test, then that is like an incongruent message. But if you hand out tests and say, oh, apparently you got like 98% right, but you got a C in effort because I saw you didn't do anything new this time. And another kid got like an A+ in effort because he tried something he'd never done before. He got like a 70% like right. But the feedback and all the discussions were around like the effort and the trial and error part, then their focus will surely shift to that part. So focus on the thing that you think is important. And self-awareness, don't measure kids around against any average. Average doesn't exist. There is no actual function in learning to know what the average is. As a student, the only thing that's functional is knowing what the next step is and how are you going to take it. And then getting feedback on how you did that process. And if you're 10 years behind, you're 10 years behind. If you're 20 years ahead, you're 20 years ahead. Completely irrelevant. The only thing is, what's my next step and how am I going to take it? What feedback am I going to give in the process of getting there? So, a general question is, you know, should the student change or should school change? And 100 years ago, the answer was the students should change. The school system is the way it is, and students should fit themselves into it. The last 30 years, we might have kind of like overcorrected to the other side. And especially ones in education will know the amount of times that the Westside schools change the school because my student won't fit. And the risk you get is, probably you know, this sport is called girding. Girding means that like a disc is shifted over the ice and two people are going to go in front of it and they're going to scrub the ice and make it completely perfectly smooth. And that's what education and parenting is like. We're going to slide our kid over the ice and we're going to run in front of it and we're going to smooth the entire way. And the thing is, it works. The disc is going to go further now. But in life, is your life without obstacles? Is your life without the mountains and the hills? So if we're going to take them all away, how can we expect our children to be able to go over those humps? And the reason why I can take pretty big humps now is because I took a lot of small humps when I was smaller. And that made me grow, made me able to deal with bigger challenges. Otherwise, you get risks in what they call the attribution theory. Who are you going to blame when things go right or wrong? So say I get a really good grade. And if the attribution theory is that I'm going to put everything outside myself, I'm going to say, well, I was lucky to get a good grade. It was an easy test and, you know, happens to be one of my strengths, so I couldn't help it. And if something goes wrong, I do the same thing. I get a failing grade. I couldn't help it. Teacher made a stupid test. You know, and I'm dyslexic. What do you expect? You know, I've got a couple of boxes that are in my way. So now I'm a martyr, or a victim. Oh, sorry, now I'm a victim. Because I'm just the play ball of the world. If I get good teachers with easy tests, I'm happy. If I get stupid teachers with stupid tests, I'm unhappy. Most of the time, it's kind of a little bit more nuanced. Most of the people go one way or the other. The martyr will say, when he gets a high grade, I was just lucky. Or when he gets a low grade, oh, that's my fault. I did something awfully wrong. Then you're always kicking yourself down. Never be happy because you're only going to focus on the things that go wrong. Equally bad is the narcissist at the other end, because every time he gets a high grade, he's like, yay, I got a high grade, ain't I cool? But oh, that bad grade, that's not my fault. No, the teacher wasn't paying attention to my visual spacing learning style. As soon as Dave thinks that, I'll fix my grade. But what you want, whether you get a high or a low grade, is that the student looks at himself. What can I do to make it better? Regardless, high grade, I don't care, low grade, what can I do to make things better? And then you're developmentally oriented. How? Say discussion, communication, attribute value, be a role model and talk about it. Most of all, don't take the obstacles away. Even if there is a stupid teacher, what are you going to do with your stupid teacher? Even if there's a teacher who doesn't care about your visual spatial learning style, what are you going to do with your visual spatial learning style with your teacher? Because then you learn to overcome those challenges. And in the process, you're going to learn the life attitude of dealing with problems as they come. Because there's nobody you can complain to when your boss isn't caring about your visual spatial learning style, or your clients aren't caring about your dyslexia. So you have to figure it out. You have to learn how to do that. And the last thing I want to talk about, I'm kind of out of time, but it's okay, is that the way you parent and the way you teach needs to be speech appropriate. Now this is a whole can of worms I could talk about like for 10 days. Like this is a system of looking at different developmental lines and different developmental levels. So it could be at different developmental levels. I'm going to skip this one, I'm going to go to a simpler version. This is actually a year-long program. The simplified version talks about that there are like three rough developmental levels and a number of developmental lines. So what do I mean with that, developmental levels? Well, you've got developmental psychology, so like Piaget, for instance, has had like a lot of theories on these. When you look at conventional, pre-conventional, and post-conventional, we can look, for instance, at art. Pre-conventional art is a kid that does whatever he wants just because he simply doesn't know anything. Then there might be a point where he learns how it should be done. You learn proper technique, you learn how to draw a realistic painting, you learn, we were looking at poems, like all the different forms of poetry that exist. So you learn the conventions around this. And then at some point, you might become post-conventional. When you look at somebody like Picasso or Mondrian or different people, they were in impressionistic because they found a way to better express reality than in a realistic way. So they knew how to do it in a conventional way. They were actually brilliant at making realistic paintings. But they figured, I can do better than that by having my own interpretation. The challenge is, and that's what Ken Wilber calls it, the pre-post fallacy, sometimes it's hard to tell these two apart. Apparently at some point, Sotheby's sold for 60,000 euros a painting made by a three-year-old. And art critics have written like 5 pages to go with it about the deep meaning that was behind this painting. Well, the kid just didn't know any better. He couldn't explain that, there wasn't an intention behind it. The kid was pretty conventional. The next challenge is that you might think about an entire kid as being pre-conventional. So I don't know how stuff should be done. I'm conventional, I know how it should be done. Or post-conventional, I know how it should be done, but I've got a more effective way. That is one thing. But within this kid, a lot of different worlds live. You've got this cognitive level, probably post-conventional. He understands how the world works and probably understands it better than most. But the question is his ego development there as well? And is his moral development there as well? Is his ability to self-regulate there? Is his emotional development there? And that is where some challenges come. Because that's where I see, because we talk a lot about disharmonic profiles, being the verbal and the personal side. But this is actually a more interesting gap to research. To look at a kid and say, wow, at a cognitive level, you're post-conventional. But probably when I look to you, for instance, at the moral level, it's pre-conventional. Pre-conventional moral level, by the way, because conventional moral level is, we do it because we agreed it. Pre-conventional is, if I didn't get caught, I wasn't wrong. That's like pre-conventional morality. You see, some kids are kids at that level. They can reason about moral philosophy like the best of them, but if you look at the moral behavior they show, it's pre-conventional. If they didn't get caught, they won't correct their behavior. And same for self-regulation or executive functions. Can you regulate yourself? Pre-conventional. I couldn't do it for the life of me. I can't focus for more than 2 minutes. Conventional. If you make my planning, I can execute it. Post-conventional, you know, I can make my own plan. Go away with your planning because I will find my own way. But what will a pre-conventional gifted kid do? Say, go away with your planning because I'm post-conventional. I don't need your plan. But then, in effect, he can't focus for more than 2 minutes and can't plan his way out of paper bag. So his cognitive level, and he might not even be aware of this, is not a match for his actual performance level. And so you see this pre-post fallacy and this kind of like the disharmony and the gap. And they're cognitively at the post-conventional level. So you always need to explain everything. But what you often see is when you start explaining this, a lot of kids will ask for external regulation. Well, if you don't give me punishment when I don't do my work, why do you expect me to do it? So what they're saying is, I understand from a higher level that this is a necessary function, but if I look at myself, I can't apply it myself, so you need to apply it for me. And if you keep doing that, you take an obstacle away, smoothing and curling the course, you know, away. So especially in self-regulation, it has to be stage appropriate. So at the stage of pre-conventionalism, the worldview is, if I didn't get caught, I wasn't wrong. And then you get to the conventional level, and you're like, what is the right way for our group? So you don't want to have like 13 different theories, like what's the way that we do these things? What would a good student do? So at the post-conventional level, it becomes, you know, what gives the best results, what is fair, what, you know, appeal to empathy and stuff like that. At the pre-conventional level, you need to have clear consequences. And that's what some of your kids are asking for. They will actually ask, you know, coming into the school, you explain the rules, you're like, well, now we're done. And somebody raises their hand, and what's going to happen if I don't do it? If there's no consequence, then probably there's no rule. That's apparently your preference. That's something else. So that's a big difference. If they're at the conventional level, clear rules are enough. Just explain these are the rules, and they'll do it. Just give clear feedback, wow, you're being a good student, wow, you did everything well. At the highest level, post-conventional, you can just discuss the end. We want it to be quiet here, and you can appeal to empathy. Now, I would get sad if you would do that. That is a clear post-conventional intervention. So what happens, as a parent and educator, is that we tend to guide kids as a level that we are at, as opposed to the level that they are at. So whereas post-conventional level, we will use post-conventional interventions. Ken Wilber describes it as, my level is right, all other levels are dangerously wrong. So you can only see it from your own level. And our tendency is to apply our own level. So what will happen, I see it a lot with parents of kids with kids, and also with educators of kids with kids, they will tend to apply the latter approach to kids who at times need the first one. They need clear consequences and clear guidance, and will do endless appeals to them. You make me so sad when you hit your sister. Yeah, good for you, I'm going to continue. And that's not because it's a bad kid. He's not evil, he's not mean, he simply lacks the emotional faculty of the ego development and the theory of mind to be able to actually empathically connect with another. And some kids actually get stuck there. I could really go into long political discussions on this as well, by the way, but let's not go there. So now what? I just want to quickly share a couple of things I've been working on, also kind of theories you can expect from me and where to find me. The seven challenges, we were just talking about it, is another presentation I did. I recorded it as well, so I'll see if I can send you the video as well if you're interested in it. So these are all the different concrete things that happen in education, like how to support memory, how to improve motivation, how to work on beliefs, and stuff like that. How to support trisexual children, but from a support needs basis. So one of the things that I work a lot with is the question, like, is it misdiagnosis? And some people claim it's always misdiagnosed, and I don't agree with that. Some people claim that misdiagnosis doesn't exist, like the truth is somewhere in the middle. So what I started working on is like a model of at what level is the problem occurring? Because we usually do our diagnosis based on behavior. You act like you have HDD, so you have HDD. But having HDD is actually a brain physiological conclusion. But there's a lot of stuff in between them. It might be just motivation. I had a kid who actually acted like an autistic kid because he saw another autistic kid not getting bullied after having episodes. So he started having them too. He was just motivated to do it. It was a very good solution to his problem of social behavior. He could change it at a whim. You could actually bribe him out of it. Sometimes he lacks skill. So looking like having HDD could just be lacking executive skills. If you train them, you have them. You just never trained them because you never needed them. It could be your beliefs. Well, you know, 6 years ago they told me I was dyslexic, so I'm not even going to train my spelling skills because I will never get them anyway. So it actually usually escalates up. Sometimes it's allergy to food. Like if I look at myself, I eat sort of things that bounce all over the place or I fall asleep 2 minutes later. Like that's just really related to food, especially gifted kids are often sensitive to a lot of these things. So you need to really rule that out. Maybe a lot of problems will go away when you find you now. You've got a pruning period. If you look, for instance, at executive functions, they usually develop, depending on which one you have, between 6 and 12 for some, and 12 and 18 for others. But if you've never trained for long focused attention before you're 18, that's going to be a hard job to fix. Because that kind of that area settled a little bit. You can always change everything, but it's going to take maybe 10 or 20 times as much training time as you take when we would have done that training with your, which was a 6-year-old or a 7-year-old. And then we get to brain physiology. Then we get to HDD's actual lack of neurotransmitters, the uptake and everything process not working well. But that's only after you, actually, theoretically, you would have to rule all of these others out before you can take a broader conclusion. And each of these levels has its own like support needs and support processes. I'm really interested in that asynchronous development part. So that's why we're working at like all those lines and levels to really kind of like take them apart and to make what we call psychograph to have a complete picture of the child. Like this is like the Kohlberg moral level you're on, this is the cognitive level you're currently functioning on, this is the Loffenberg ego development stage. So all these different things like to really get a picture of this is where you're at and this is the way we're going to guide you to the next level. Bright Future for a Bright Mind, we talked about like a book I'm writing about how the future is changing and how to prepare our children for that. And School of Understanding is a place to apply all of this. To really still do all these things, but by shifting your focus and using technology as a tool. So that's also why we created Robize as a software tool to gather feedback from as many places as possible to not have like the administrative burden put on the teacher. Like students should track their own progress and we should look over their shoulder as opposed to the teacher being the one, you know, sitting there at 3:30, you know, writing all the reports and doing all the registration. So I hope I was able to give you an overview, get practical, and talk really fast for a really long time. You're really good at listening. Where you can see me, I'm going to be at CAG, week and a half. So maybe I'll see you guys then on Sunday. I'll give a presentation on Bright Future for a Bright Mind, so the technology bit, the changing world, and what to teach them. It's going to be more lovely after that. If this was valuable, I hope you guys will help me a little bit. And that's mostly by spreading it. If I'm going to send you the video, if you think somebody's interested, send it to them. If you're a school and you're like, oh, this is cool, I'd love to work with you. We really are looking at doing exchange programs with our school, or it gives a dropout program, or I'd love to come by, like as Dave said, I came by to do a parent night to address some of the issues that we were talking about. Like sometimes it's nice if somebody else tells your parents the stories. Same at our place, I invite people to do it to my parents. Like, you really try to work together and share information. So I really hope we can do that together. If you have any ideas or anything that could be beneficial, I would really like to hear it. And I think that's about it. And a good moment to get to the parents.